Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar AIS Academy. These are a list of news articles selected for today's analysis and their page numbers in different editions of the newspaper. The link for the handwritten notes in the PDF format and the timestamping of the discussed articles will be provided in the description and also in the comment section for the benefit of mobile phone viewers. Now let's move on to the analysis of first news article. This news article states that India's current account deficit has widened in the January to March quarter this year. Last year in the same quarter, we saw a surplus in the current account of $0.6 billion. However, this year we are seeing a deficit. The main reason for the widening CAD was the revival in import demand from our side, particularly in the gold imports. In this context, let us understand basic economic terms like balance of payments, its components, etc. The syllabus relevant for the analysis is highlighted here for your reference. See, balance of payments summarize the economic transactions of an economy with the rest of the world for a specific period. The compilation and dissemination of BOP data in India, it is the primary responsibility of banking regulator, the Reserve Bank of India. See, the presentation of BOP data since the liberalization, that is since 1990 to 91, is based on the recommendations of a high-level committee on balance of payments 1993. Now, this committee was chaired by Dr. C. Rangarajan, who is a former RBI governor. Now, coming to BOP, see, it can be broadly divided into two accounts. One is current account and the other is capital account. When we say current account, it is the account that records all the transactions relating to trade in goods and services. Or in other words, all the transactions relating to export and import of goods and services. So what do you mean by capital account? See, this account records all those transactions between residents of a country and the rest of the world in the assets or liabilities. So these transactions, they cause a change in assets or liabilities of residents of the country or its government. So in other words, we can say that capital account reflects the net changes in financial claims on the rest of the world. Now know that current account is further subdivided into goods or merchandise account and services or invisibles account. The merchandise account consists of transactions relating to exports and imports of goods. If you take invisible account, there are three broad categories. First one is non-factor services like travel, transportation, insurance and miscellaneous services. Then comes transfers which do not involve any value in exchange. Thirdly, there is income which includes compensation of employees and investment income. So what is the meaning of travel here? See, travel represents all expenditure by foreign tourists in India on the receipt side, and it includes all expenditure by Indian tourists abroad on payment side, right? Travel receipts largely depend on arrival of foreign tourists in India during a particular period. We spoke about investment income. It represents servicing of capital transactions. That is how we are going to service debt transactions and non-debt transactions. These transactions are in the form of interest, dividend and profit for servicing of capital transactions. If you take interest payments, they represent servicing of debt liabilities. While we take dividend and profit payments, they reflect the servicing of non-debt liabilities. What are these non-debt aspects we are talking here? They are the FDA and portfolio investment. Alright, so the servicing of FDA and portfolio liabilities is done through the payment of dividend and profits. And coming to transfers, see, they represent one-sided transactions. Alright, they include grants, gifts and migrants transfers by way of remittances for family maintenance, then repatriation of savings, transfer of financial and real resources that are linked to change in resident status of migrants. This also includes official transfer receipts, which record grants, donations, and other assistance received by the government from bilateral and multilateral institutions. Similar transfers by our government to other countries are also recorded under official transfer payments. Now, we saw about compensation of employees component. See, this means it includes wages received by Indians working on foreign contracts, and it includes payment of wages or salary to non-residents who are working in India. Alright, these are some of the areas that are in the invisibles account or the service account within the current account. Now, coming to capital account, that can be broken up into two categories. First is non-debt flows like direct and portfolio investments. Second is debt flows like external assistance, commercial borrowings, non-resident deposits, etc. Now, the sum of current account and capital account indicates overall balance, which could either be in surplus or in deficit. The movement in overall balance is reflected in the changes in the international reserves of the country. Now, let us understand what exactly is current account deficit. See, we saw that a nation's current account maintains a record of country's transactions with other nations in terms of goods and services. It also records net earnings on overseas investments and net transfer of payments over a period of time, such as remittances. Now, this account goes into deficit when money sent outward is more than the money that is coming inward. So, current account deficit is the difference between the money that is coming in because of our exports and the money that is flowing out because of the things and services that we import into India. In terms of trade gap or the mercantile gap, that is nothing but exports minus imports. If the exports are more, there will be trade surplus. That is, the value of exports are more, there will be trade surplus. If the imports are more, there will be trade deficit. Coming to current account, it includes trade gap plus net current transfers plus net income abroad. So, like we said, this can be a surplus or a deficit. Today's article states that CAD widened in January-March quarter because of higher trade deficit and because of lower net invisible receipts. Alright, these are some of the information with reference to the analysis of this news article. In this analysis, we discussed about balance of payments, its components, current account, capital account, components of current account, alright, etc. Now, let us move on to next part of the discussion. See, this economics news article, a small news article for our discussion, it says that core sector output has grown at around 17%. And experts say it is because of base effect. So, what do you mean by base effect? See, it is nothing but the impact of either increase or decrease in growth compared to the previous reference year. Last year, during May, we had severe lockdown. Almost no economic activity happened. Therefore, the growth was low at that point of time. And compared to last year, that is compared to May 2020, we seem to have a better growth at 17%. But the devil is in the detail, because the 17 number looks big. But last year no growth happened. So if you compare with last year, the growth of 17% will look huge. However, the growth has been muted. That is, it is not sound or strong. See, it is more like how a small line will look larger in comparison to a much smaller line. That is what base effect here means. It is a relative parameter. Now, here the growth has been measured through the core sector output. So, in this part of discussion, let us know what is this core sector output is from the exam point of view. So, let us talk about index of core industries or index of 8 core industries. See, as the title suggests, this is an index of 8 most fundamental industrial sectors of Indian economy. And if you see, it maps the volume of production in these industries. That is, how much or how many units are produced is measured. Now, to know that, ICA adopts a fixed basket approach. That is, the index of 8 core industries measures collective as well as individual performance of production in the selected 8 core industries that contributes most to our economy. Now, what are these 8 core industries? Coal, crude oil, natural gas, refinery products, fertilizers, then steel, cement and electricity. Now, as you can see here, the highest weightage within index of 8 core industries goes to refinery products and the lowest weightage goes to fertilizers. And know that each industry is assigned a weightage based on the weight of these industries given in index of industrial production. What is the meaning of this statement? See, you multiply the weights given for the appropriate sectors in IIP. Multiply the number with 2.484. You will get approximately what are the weights given in ICA or index of 8 core industries. Alright. So, of the total weight of index of industrial production, we can find that the combined weight of these 8 core industries is 40.27%. Now, simply put, you know, the 8 core industries contribute 40% of the score in the index of industrial production. In other words, we can also say that these 8 core industries are a subset in the IIP.
Now remember that this report of ICI or the Index of 8 Core Industries is published on a monthly basis with the base year as 2011-12. Yesterday they have released it for the month of or for the reference period of May 2021. And note that it also releases a year-on-year growth as well as month-on-month growth. And that is when the base effect comes into picture as we discussed earlier. So the index is released by the Office of Economic Advisor, who is coming under the Department of Promotion of Industry and Internal Trade of Union Ministry of Commerce and Industry. On the other hand, if you take Index of Industrial Production, all right, that is the IIP. If you saw recently on June 11, the Union Ministry of Statistics and Program Implementation released quick estimates of Index of Industrial Production. And in the month of June, they released there in IIP, the last reference period is for the month of April 2021. This is because the quick estimates of Index of Industrial Production were released by National Statistical Office of Ministry of Statistics and Program Implementation on 12th of every month. On 12th of June, if 12th of June is holiday, they will publish it on previous working day, that is on June 11. However, there will be a 6 weeks lag in IIP. That is why they published on June 11 for the month of April 2021. On the other hand, if you take Index of 8 Core Industries, they usually been released on last day of the month for the previous month. That is, yesterday they released for the month of May 2021. So these are some of the information with reference to the analysis of this news article. Now let's move on to the analysis of next news article. This editorial article is an analysis of Communist Party of China and its success in the long survival. Let us learn about it. The syllabus relevant for the analysis is highlighted here for your reference. See, many believe that China under the leadership of Mao Zedong became Shan Chilai, that means stand up. And many believed that China became Fu Chilai under the leadership of Deng Xiaoping, that is China became rich during his tenure. Finally, under Xi Jinping, China is well on course to Xiang Chilai, means to become powerful. So they say that these three leaders of Communist Party of China have led to the rise of China. So the Communist Party of China has been a very important part of Chinese history more recently. The Communist Party of China has also managed many domestic and external crises for a long period of time. But how did the party survive for so long? See, the party's longevity is because of its ability mainly to sum up the lessons of history and to change course quite drastically whenever required. This is the theme. This editorial is an analysis of major lessons that have guided the Communist Party of China over the course of the past century. Let us discuss it. So the first major lesson was drawn from colonial era. See, during colonial era, China was carved up like a melon. It means China was split into many parts because of colonial subjugation. And this was seen as a humiliation heaped by the Western colonial powers. So when the Qing Empire collapsed in 1911, it brought about the desired political revolution in China. It also kindled the spirit of nationhood. This is the major lesson which has guided the Communist Party during its long tenure in China. The party used this lesson effectively and accomplished victory during many crises. See, during many crises, the Communist Party of China has given the people of China a collective purpose. The collective purpose has led to the rejuvenation of China by giving them a national identity. But how did the party achieve it? See, this party had a strong ideological backing. In addition to that, it also had superb organization skills. See, it made use of highly disciplined People Liberation Army to power its aspirations. All these factors helped the Communist Party to bring one big explosive social revolution where it demolished an entire social class. And the author says that this was seen as the liberation and the birth of a new China. What is this demolition of entire social class? See, Chinese government carried out land reforms under the leadership of Mao Zedong. Many killings that were associated with these land reforms were called as classicide. The then ideology, it included dividing people into five class categories depending on their possession of land, capital, property and income. Five categories were landlord class, rich peasant class, middle peasant class, poor worker and peasant classes. Those who were in the lower classes, they were praised for their humble way of life and their work ethic. However, the landlords and the wealthy, they were criticized, demonized and persecuted. Their property was seized by the government and they were also sent to do hard manual labor in the countryside. In fact, many of them were killed. That is what here the author refers to as demolishing an entire social class. So
This was seen as liberation and the birth of new China. It gave way to a famous slogan in China, which translates in English into, if there had been no Communist Party, there would not have been a new China. It is said that such a comprehensive political, economic and social destruction is unparalleled in the history of modern revolutions. There are a lot of negatives associated with this violent revolution. Maybe we'll discuss it on some other day. Then the party stresses the importance of standing up to external forces which seek to impose their ways on China. Even though they may not seek to impose their ways on China, the party will consider it as imposing their ways on China. This is another major lesson used by CPC. CPC still uses this attitude whenever the issues of Tibet and Taiwan sovereignty are brought up, whenever any human rights violations in China was criticized at the international level. According to Chinese Communist Party, these issues are an attack on China's sovereignty. So there are no values associated with that. No matter what, it will consider it as an attack on Chinese sovereignty. It sees them as a dilution of national interest, which will lead to the imposition of Western values. So the party pushes for strong responses to any perceived attack on China's sovereignty. And according to this party, the authority and power of the ruling elite in China can under no circumstances be undermined in the eyes of its people. So this is one another reason that has made the party survive for a long period. Next important lesson that has guided this party is the Sinicization of Marxism. See, CPC Sinicized Marxism before applying it to Chinese conditions. The Communist Party believed Marxism was a foreign concept, so it had to be altered to the Chinese requirements of successful implementation. Now, this is called Sinicization of Marxism. It did not go directly for the Soviet model, or it did not go directly to the capitalist model. Because, see, China adopted Marxism to China's modern requirements. These changes have made this party thrive in China till date. One can easily relate to the famous saying of Deng Xiaoping, who said that it doesn't matter whether a cat is black or white, meaning, you know, the communism color is red, and in fact, it means that it doesn't matter whether a cat is black or white or red. As long as it catches mice, it is fine. All right. So the objective should be achieved and the model need not be exactly kept intact. In fact, it is said that while India opened up in 1990-1991 with LPG liberalization and reforms, China did that 20 years ago. At that time, the saying was very famous in the international arena and in China. Now, next important lesson for CPC came out of Tiananmen crisis of 1989. See, at that period of time, certain sections of China, particularly youth and workers, they were dissatisfied with the economic reforms and the massive corruption at the level of Communist Party. This led to massive demonstrations, and these demonstrations were crushed by strong and brutal use of force. Many had been killed. The numbers are not yet been released, and there is a ban on remembrance of this event in China. All right, these events, according to the party leadership, has created a lot of chaos and instability in the country. So the party went to curtail the political freedoms. So what did the party learn from this event, or from arresting this event? The party decided any such thing should be severely curtailed and arrested, because if China want to achieve its economic objectives, it could not afford chaos or protests or such demonstrations. There must be stability, and stability was accorded top priority by this party, and therefore the nation's energy should be channelized only into getting rich. All right. And therefore they even started clamping down on political freedoms. Centralizing tendencies gained the upper hand. CPC is now forcing every unit of organization in China, political, economic, social and cultural, to function within the parameters set by this Communist Party. And this has made it a very important part of China. Even it has created a situation where China cannot function without the party. This has again contributed to its survival. The next important lesson for the CPC stemmed from structural transformation of post-World War II international order. In particular, the disintegration of Soviet Union and the collapse of socialist bloc in 1991. See, the Soviet Union under Mikhail Gorbachev rejected the Stalinist period. But the Chinese party believed that this rejection of past party leaders had weakened the Communist Party in the Soviet Union. So they wanted to ensure such a mistake should never be done in China. So it embraces its past history and leaders
And CPC also forces its firm control over the market forces that makes the Chinese economy heavily reliant on this party. So these are the lessons which have guided Chinese Communist Party during its long tenure. So these are the lessons which have guided the party during its long tenure. See, CPC has a lot of achievements under its belt seen at the national level. It has brought nearly 80 crore people out of poverty. That is a huge achievement. But it has also created huge inequalities in Chinese society. This must be relative when we compare it with countries. And so there have been a lot of criticisms with respect to such inequalities. And China has failed to act as a responsible major power during the current pandemic, though it had the opportunity to demonstrate itself as a major power. It has also created a lot of environmental challenges in today's scenario. Then it has also recently shrunk state welfare packages, and this has made the elderly population in China more vulnerable. And there is also gender imbalance because of some unscientific policies of the Communist Party. Now China is struggling because of these issues. However, note that CPC, the Communist Party of China, is the core of China. So if one has to understand China, we have to understand this party. It is very important. Though it is a vast land, many occasions, particularly in voting and all, there is huge, huge solidarity. So it is important to understand the nature and power of this organization and also its strengths and weaknesses. And if at all there is any best practices, we can take it. And if at all there is some mistakes, weaknesses, we can learn from it and we should avoid it in our future. We should also study how the party was able to capture the imagination of people, particularly youth. In fact, we should also study about its capacity for reinventing, regenerating and renewing its relationship with the Chinese population. And with China is becoming increasingly an authoritarian party state, it is important for us to know about this party to learn about China comprehensively. Now, why there have been some articles about the Communist Party of China today? This is because today is celebrated as 100th anniversary of the founding of the Communist Party of China. See, the CPC was founded on 1st July 1921, 100 years ago. It led the Chinese people to achieve national independence and liberation through 28 years of hard fight and sacrifice. Then it founded People's Republic of China in 1949. Then it launched reform and opening up in 1978. And this assured the new era of socialism with Chinese characteristics. And since 1978, China has been growing and has a strong regional and international influence and has also brought brilliant prospects for its people. So this is the story from the Chinese government side. Now let's move on to the next part of the discussion. This news article is with reference to tourism sector and how COVID-19 pandemic has affected it. As we know, the pandemic has severely affected our lives. But there is one sector that has taken a heavy hit because of the COVID-19 pandemic, which is the tourism sector. It has been severely affected by the pandemic. See, according to a report from UN institutions, because of the collapse of international tourism due to COVID-19, it has costed the world around $4 trillion in terms of global GDP for the 2 years 2020 and 2021. This report is titled as COVID-19 and Tourism, an Update. It was jointly released by UN Conference on Trade and Development and UN World Tourism Organization. According to this report, India experienced a 54% drop in the tourist arrivals last year. The report also cited that tourism is not expected to return to pre-COVID levels even until 2023 or later. So it will take years to achieve normalcy in this sector. Maybe achieving in 2024 could be optimistic. This will cost the world somewhere between $1.7 trillion and $2.4 trillion in the current year. And this estimate is based on three scenarios, one being optimistic, two being pessimistic, and three considering there is an uneven rollout of vaccines. Some nations 60% is achieved, in some nations it is in this level of single digits. Alright. So according to this report, developing countries will account for the majority of losses and due to the asymmetric rollout of vaccines. And tourism is likely to pick up faster this summer in North America and Europe where vaccination rates are higher, and it will be the case even in nations where there are which have achieved 60% vaccination coverage, wherever they may be. The loss in the tourism sector will be particularly felt by two group of people, one women and young people. This is because the sector employs significant proportions of these population. And according to the report, some 10 crore to 12 crore tourism jobs are at stake because of the pandemic. The report also recommended quick rollout of vaccines at the global level to bring back tourism, particularly in developing countries. The report also appreciated an initiative at the European Union level called as the EU Digital COVID Certificate Initiative. Now, this certificate will facilitate safe and free movement of citizens in the European Union during the pandemic. What is this EU Digital COVID Certificate? See, this certificate is a digital proof that a person has either been vaccinated against COVID-19 or either received a negative test result or either recovered from COVID-19. Now, the key features of the certificate, it will be in digital and or paper format with QR code, which is free of charge, which is in national language and in English, which will be safe and secure and which will be valid in all European Union countries. So such initiatives will boost up the tourism sector given the current challenges. The report also recommended socio-economic measures to protect livelihoods, particularly in the tourism sector. But report says that some tourism related businesses, even though restrictions are removed, may not survive for quite a long time. So such businesses should be supported by the government for that period of time until normalcy is witnessed in those specific tourism related businesses. So these are some of the information with reference to the analysis of this news article. Now let's move on to the next part of the discussion. This article is an interview article with Montak Singh Ahluwalia, who was an important figure of liberalization reform process and who was also former deputy chairman of erstwhile planning commission. So based on this interview article, let us have a comprehensive overview on what he has shared. The syllabus covered by this article is highlighted here for your reference. The article is about liberalization. It refers to a relaxation of government restrictions in the areas of social, political and economic policies. When it comes to the context of economic policy, liberalization refers to lessening of government regulations and government restrictions. Thereby, there is greater participation by private sector or private entities. Objective is to encourage economic development. And as we know, in India, economic liberalization was initiated in 1991. The goal was to make the economy more market-oriented. It aimed at expanding the role of private and foreign investment, that is, investment from domestic private and foreign investment, in a manner that ensured an adequate flow of benefits to the poverty-stricken group among the Indian population. Now, coming to the article, before the reforms or prior to the reforms, the control system in the Indian economy was very rigid and it restricted entrepreneurship. For example, private sector was not allowed to invest in a number of sectors. Even if private was allowed, it could invest only after getting an industrial license. And getting such an industrial license was at that time normally not very easy, particularly for large industrial houses. Similarly, during that phase, prior to the reforms, imports were more strictly controlled. It was done with the objective to conserve the limited foreign exchange reserves available back then. More importantly, the import of technology was controlled and even FDI was discouraged. And by going through the situation prior to the reforms, we can understand that there was a need for a drastic change. So as a result, and we also faced BOP crisis in 1990. And after this, many planning and initiatives were undertaken. Then 1991 reforms came during the period when P.V. Narasimha Rao was the Prime Minister and Sri Manmohan was the Finance Minister. When you look at the evolution of economy since 1991 liberalization reforms, we undertook a gradualistic approach. That is, it took time to achieve the benefits of liberalization. We have seen some very good results. For example, the GDP growth, it averaged 7% in the 25 years from 1992 to 2017. Whereas if you take the GDP growth during the preceding 10 years, that is the 10 years before 1992, it was an average of 5% only. And in fact, preceding 20 years, it was 4%, right? So we have seen an increase in economic growth. And with that, poverty gradually began to decline. However, some sectors like health, education and environmental concerns, they were not given adequate recognition in these reforms. And there are also some reforms still pending, particularly in two important areas, labor and land. Then the author talks about India's decision to stay out of RCEP, that is Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership. See, unwillingness to join such regional initiatives or forums is seen by one particular section of economists as going back from market-oriented development or market-oriented partnership. However, it has positives, and for Indian case, current scenario, there are a lot of negatives. Now, coming to the opinion of author states that India has to enhance its competitiveness. Then only even if India joins RCEP, it can a lot of benefits. We do have, if we join RCEP, there will be unfair competition from China. For that, author suggests that you should impose anti-dumping duties on China. And he also says that should be done, and raising import duties in general should not be done. And we are seeing that world countries are slowly reducing their dependence on China. At such a juncture, even though India may not exactly replace China, but we can become a major player in non-China dominated supply chains. So we should take advantage of those supply chains by joining RCEP, that is the opinion of the author. Thereby, that will also reassure partners that trade policy will not be arbitrarily changed. Now, with respect to free trade agreements, author feels that working on agreements with important groups at the bilateral level seems to be the only hope for assuring market access. But then that requires more give-and-take policy even on some contentious issues. For this, India should be willing. Now, coming to the present, we know that the pandemic has led to a collapse in employment. And as per the national income estimates, GDP has contracted by 7.3% in 2020-2021. Therefore, as of now, the priority must be to get the vaccination coverage and its expansion as soon as possible, because it creates conditions conducive to return to normalcy. And doing that, we can achieve the level of economic recovery that we saw in 2019-20. And once we attain that level of economic recovery, government can analyze the grounds that caused the slowdown even before the pandemic. And based on it, mutually supportive policies can be devised so as to attain higher growth, to attain higher employment with the target of post-pandemic growth. So these are some of the important points from this OPED article. In this article, we talked about liberalization, the author's opinion on joining RCEP, the gaps that need to be filled so as to have good post-pandemic growth. Now let's move on to next part of the discussion.
This article is regarding PATROD or Colocasia leaf rolls. See, PATROD has been identified as one of the traditional food recipe from the Ayush system of medicine by the Union Ministry of Ayush.
Now, we know that India has a very rich tradition of diverse food practices in different parts of our nation. Many of us may be unaware of the treasure that has been passed to us by the ancestors. So this Ayush compilation of recipe is largely a comprehensive exploration of traditional systems of eating for health and nourishment. Now, this book encompasses cooking methods of some selected traditional food items and their health benefits. The objective of this booklet is to create awareness in the community regarding Ayush-based healthy food habits. So today let us discuss in brief about PATROD. See, it's a delicacy made with colocasia leaves. It is popular in Malnad in Karnataka and also in coastal Karnataka. In Kerala, this dish is called Chembila Appam. The dish is also prepared in parts of Maharashtra, Goa, Himachal Pradesh, Gujarat and the northeastern region. Know that PATROD is widely cooked in Malnad belts during the rainy season. Now, about this region, it is in Karnataka state, covers western and eastern slopes of Western Ghats. It has a width of 100 km. It's a hilly terrain, comes under a heavy rainfall belt. So this Malnad region is humid, has an annual rainfall of 100 cm to 380 cm. Agumbe, which is in Shivamoga district, receives highest rainfall in Karnataka, close to 1000 centimeters. It is also therefore called as Karnataka's Cherrapunji. Now let us see some health benefits of PATROD. First of all, it is easily digestible, and because they are rich in dietary fibers, help in easy bowel movement. See, this iron-rich colocasia leaves helps in improving the hemoglobin. Know that the leaves contain phenols, tannins, flavonoids, glycosides and sterols. They help in reducing chronic inflammation like rheumatoid arthritis. Apart from this, the leaves have significant amounts of vitamin C and beta-carotene. As we said, the Ayush booklet has given several contraindications as well. A contraindication is a specific situation in which a drug, procedure or surgery should not be used because it may be harmful to a person. In case of PATROD, using too much of oil makes it unsuitable for cardiac patients, those who are having diabetes and those who are obese, etc. And also too much spice is not recommended in acid peptic diseases. Some of the other traditional food recipe selected by Ministry of Ayush are Amalaki Panaka or Indian gooseberry drink, Takra or buttermilk, Kulatha rasam or horse gram rasam, and Niger seeds laddu, etc. So these are some of the information with reference to the analysis of this news article. Now let's move on to next part of the discussion.
Now see this news article. It reports about a statement made by the president of Clay Mathematics Institute on the availability of Riemann hypothesis. The statement was made in response to a claim that was made by a person from Hyderabad who claims that he has solved the problem. And this problem that he is reportedly solved, that he is claiming, has puzzled the mathematicians for the past 162 years. So in this regard, let us know about this Riemann hypothesis. See, as we know in mathematics, some numbers have the special property that they cannot be expressed as the product of two smaller numbers. For example, 2, 3, 5, 7, 11, and etc. And these numbers, we call them as prime numbers, and they play an important role both in pure mathematics and in the applications. But it is found that the distribution of these prime numbers among all the natural numbers does not follow any regular pattern. On the contrary, if you take arithmetic progression series or geometric progression series and few other series are there, they have a regular interval or a regular frequency, or we can predict like that. However, the distribution of prime numbers was found to not following any regular pattern. In this juncture, a German mathematician by name G.F.P. Riemann, he observed that the frequency of prime numbers is very closely related to the behavior of one elaborate function. And this is that function. And this function is named as Riemann zeta function. And his hypothesis asserts that all interesting solutions of an equation called as this lie on a certain vertical straight line. And this has been checked for first 10 trillion solutions. However, the problem is still alive and they are unable to say it very clearly, like how we say that Pythagoras' theorem is true for all right-angle triangles. So like that, there is no conclusive solution or proof with respect to Riemann hypothesis. And if that becomes true, mathematicians are saying that it will shed light on a lot of mysteries surrounding the distribution of prime numbers, and it will have a lot of applications as well. Now for civil services, for our examination perspective, for prelims particularly, we should know something about everything, particularly for prelims. In mains it is everything about something. So we should know in which field is this term, Riemann hypothesis, is relevant. It is relevant in the field of mathematics. And within mathematics, it is associated with the distribution of prime numbers. These two information is enough. And another information that it is still unsolved. That's all. Now let's move on to next part of the discussion. We have come to the last session, the practice questions discussion session. Now see this question. They are asking us to arrange the following in the increasing order of weightage with reference to index of 8 core industries. Electricity, refinery products, fertilizer, coal. Now you may be thinking, can UPSC frame such a question? If you take UPSC prelims question paper of 2012, we can find a very similar question asking to arrange in some order of the, particularly in the connection with index of 8 core industries. Here if we know that refinery products has got the highest weightage, we can easily arrive at the correct answer, option A, because only option A has the mention of refinery products in the last. Know that the least weightage goes to fertilizer at about 2.62%, and the second weightage goes to electricity. The second highest weightage goes to electricity. So the correct answer is option A. Now this question is with respect to current account. Two statements are given. They are asking which of the statements given above are correct. First statement, the current account records exports and imports in goods and services but not the transfer payments. This statement is incorrect. They record also the transfer payments. Now the second statement, transfer payments are receipts which the residents of a country receive for free without having to make any future payments in return. This statement is also correct. They could be remittances, gifts and grants, right? And they could be official or private. The statement is taken from NCERT textbook. The correct answer for this question is option B, 2 only. See this question about PAT road. Recently, PAT road, Colocasia leaf rules,
has been identified as one of the traditional food recipe by the Union Ministry of Ayush. Which of the following SR are its health benefits? It is rich in iron and helps in improving hemoglobin. It contains flavonoids, glycosides and sterols. It has significant amounts of vitamin C and beta carotene. All the above. Correct answer is option D, all the above. Now this question is with reference to Riemann hypothesis. The Riemann hypothesis deals with which of the following concepts? Rational numbers, distribution of prime numbers, natural numbers, real numbers. The correct answer is option B, distribution of prime numbers. See this question, COVID-19 and tourism, an update report is released by option A, UNCTAD, UN Conference on Trade and Development and United Nations World Tourism Organization. We have given two practice mains questions. You may write the answers and post them in the comment section for peer review. With this, we come to the end of today's The Hindu News Analysis. If you like the video, click the like button, comment, share and subscribe to Shankar AIS Academy YouTube channel for more updates and content on civil service exam preparation.